So, welcome to the third lecture on the testing part on fault equivalence. So, in the last lecture, what we had discussed was that for testing a circuit, be it functional or structural, the idea is that we have given a circuit and then if there are any input kind of thing, so we have to apply some test patterns and we have to find out whether this output response matches with the golden response. Okay. Then our idea was that we have seen that if we go for a full functional testing, then the odd number of inputs was 2 to the power n, which was quite high and is almost impossible to apply to the high expensive test equipments if you have to apply around 2 to the power n patterns. Then we said that we can go for some kind of a structural testing. So, in structural testing, what our idea was that the whole bigger circuit of say which had n inputs, you break it up into small modules, which is having say some 3 inputs, this having 2 inputs and these have 5 inputs or some number of inputs, and then you test this functionally, you test this one functionally, you test this block individually functionally. And that was about the functional test at the structural level. That is, you are testing this guy or the smaller module functionally, but you are not checking whether this interface is proper or not. So, this is kind of a structural testing at the module level, where the module is a small blocks of circuit like this. Now, the question also we had asked in the end of the last lecture, that if these modules are quite large in number, then what is the idea? If these modules are quite large in number, then less number of interconnects has to be checked. Like for example, if you consider the case where this is your whole block which have some n inputs, then you break it up into say 2 modules, which is n by 2 and n by 2. So, then less number of interconnects has to be tested, means has to be verified, or idea is that you have to test this one individually, you have to test this one functionally individually, and then the structural part is this block itself. Then what happens, this less number of interconnects in there. And also in the last lecture we have seen what do you call this in structural testing, this intermediate, for this intermediate modules you have to either control or you have to observe. So, if you have to control, then you have to put some 2:1 multiplexer, or you have to put a shift register kind of a thing. Similarly, if you have to observe these intermediate lines, then you have to bring these pin outs, or you should have another shift register to observe them. So, if the number of intermediate lines are less, so the number of extra circuitry is less. But if the intermediate lines are small, that means the modules, intermediate modules which are you are testing at structural level, the modules are large in size, and the ratio in which n decreases may not be large, I mean that enough, right. For example, you can have n by 2 and n by 2. So, 2 to the power n by 2 is not a small number. But on the other hand, if you make this elements, or what do you call this, the elements you want to test structurally are quite small. So, you have some 2 inputs here, you have 3 inputs, and so on, some 5 inputs ... So, the whole n inputs you are breaking up into small modules, and this one you are testing functionally, this one you are testing functionally and so forth. So, now lot of intermediate wires are more. So, you have to put more number of shift registers or more number of 2:1 muxes and pin outs to have controllability and observability of the intermediate lines. But now, the what do you call this modules, or what you call the structural elements or structural blocks, are now having less number of pins. So, it is actually 2 to the power 3 plus 2 to the power 3 2 sorry plus 2 to the power 5 ... So, the number of test patterns that need to be applied is quite less. It is 2 to the power 3 plus 2 to the sorry 2 to the power 2 plus 2 to the power 3 plus 2 to the power 5 and so on. So, number of test patterns are smaller because n you have broken down into small numbers, but now the large number of intermediate wires are coming into picture. So, that is what is the answer to the first question of the yesterday's last lecture, in which we have asked the question that if these modules are quite large in number, large in size, or large means the more number of pinouts, then what is the problem? So, the problem is that you have the n does not reduce in that amount. So, you have to apply a large number of test patterns, but the interconnections we are less, so less amount of what do you call this 2:1 multiplexer or registers has to be applied. On the other hand, if your modules or the modules or on which you are going to test functionally, or which are the blocks of your structural testing, are having very less number of inputs, then the number of test patterns to be applied is less, but on the other hand you have a large number of interconnects in between them again. So, the now it is more number of 2:1 multiplexer pin outs or shift registers are required. So, there is a trade off if you are doing this without a fault model. But now, the next question was that if then what is fault model? In case of fault model, so if this is a circuit and you have smaller modules in between them, then we do not test this one structurally. This is actually structural test with a function with fault model. The previous one we discussed was a structural test without a fault model. So, in fault model what we do? We just say that we do not want to test this functionality of this, rather we want to find out that this circuit should not have any fault from a fault list. So, we have seen lot of fault model like stuck at fault, bridging fault, delay faults, etcetera. But among them the stuck at fault is the most widely accepted one because it is simple to handle as well as it can give you an accuracy or what you call confidence of 99.9% plus that if you are doing structural testing at stuck at fault then the circuit is not having any defect which is as accurate as 99.9%. So, in this case what happens even if you are in this case if you are having a structural test with a functional structural testing with fault model, then if you have a bigger circuit like this then you are breaking up into smaller modules, then we can have interconnects etcetera, then we are not bothered about functional testing of this block or functional testing of this block. We are rather bothered that this net should not have any stuck at fault, this net should not have any stuck at fault, similarly this net should not have stuck at fault and this net should not have stuck at fault and so on as per the stuck at fault model. And then we have also shown that for this it is such a good stuff that you need not have any pinouts extra, neither you need to have any 2:1 multiplexer, neither you need to have any shift registers extra if you are going to do a structural testing at using a fault model. So, that is why the second question was, does really any stuck at fault happen? The answer is no. Really do not stuck at fault really may not happen in a circuit, but what actually happens in stuck at fault is that from 2 to the power n, that is all possible testing factors you can apply, we need to apply say some k test patterns which is feasible within a time. Now, the question is which k test patterns you have to apply among this 2 to the power n. 2 to the power n is a larger set, full superset, and then among them you have to apply only some k amount of test patterns. Now, which k? Actually stuck at fault tells you which k to apply. It will say that apply a stuck at fault, like for example, we have said that if you are given an AND gate something like this and then you say that stuck at fault here to input AND gate. So, it says that a stuck at fault here means the 2-input AND gate. So, a stuck at fault, stuck at 0 fault here, you want to test it. So, it says that you apply 1-1 and you verify the output to be 1, if the answer is 1 it is correct, else the stuck at 0 fault is there. So, this 1-1 to test the stuck at 0 fault here you are applying a 1-1. So, that means this stuck at fault is implying that you apply this pattern. So, each stuck at fault implies one test pattern. So, if you have n number of wires, then we have seen that at most you can have 2n number of stuck at faults, that means 2n number of patterns where 2n is equal to k number of patterns. So, stuck at fault is giving you a very good subset of 2 to the power n which if you apply then you are going to say that we are 99.9% sure that your circuit do not have a defect. So, stuck at fault as such do not appear, but they give you a guideline regarding which subset of test patterns to apply that can give you a very high count, I mean very high confidence. So, what we will see in today's lecture? In today's lecture we will see that if there are n lines in this in a circuit, then you can assume that we have 2 to the power n stuck at fault, that is one stuck at 0 and one stuck at 1. But today we will see that in fact that is much less than 2 to the power n because some faults are equivalent. That means, if you apply a test pattern, more than one stuck at fault will be tested. That means, we will require in reality number of test patterns required to test stuck at fault is much less than even 2 to the power n. So, 2n is extreme fully functional test, then 2n that is equivalent to test equivalent to your structural test with fault model is comes to 2n means one line stuck 0 stuck 1, so 2, but then we will see today using fault equivalence that this 2n further comes down to a much lower number. So, that then what happens is that with a very low number of test patterns say p in number, we can have confidence of 2 to the power n test factors with 99.9% plus accuracy. So, we will see again the beauty of stuck at fault model that not also 2n, it is much less than 2n test patterns has to be applied. So, today we will see how it is possible. So, as I told you, so if a circuit has 2n bits, I mean so 2n nights, so we know that, sorry, if a circuit has n nets, so there can be 2n stuck at faults because stuck at 0 and stuck at 1, so it is linear. Okay, so, the question arises if you assume that there is one test pattern is required for each fault, so number of test pattern required is 2n which is much less than 2 to the power n, that is fine, so we are quite happy with it. But now, we will see that it is even much less than 2n. That is the number of stuck at faults will be much less than 2n, or in other words the number of test pattern requests to test all these 2n faults are much less than 2n. That means, what one pattern will test multiple stuck at faults. Multiple stuck at faults will be tested by a single pattern, that we will see which is can be possible by fault equivalence. So let us go to the yesterday's or last day's example. So this is a circuit. So let there be a Stuckert fault here, Stuckert 1 fault. So obviously we have seen that the pattern to test the Stuckert 1 fault is a 0 over here. So if you apply a 0 over here, the fault gets sensitized. So sensitized means if the no fault is there, this net will be 0. If fault is there, the net is 1. And to visualize this fault effect at this point, you have to keep all the lines as 1. So in the output of this AND gate, you will get 1 if there is fault and 0 if there is no fault. Similarly, this propagation to the output has to be done. So you have to apply once at all this. So this test pattern I equal to 0, this one is a test pattern for Stuckert 1 at net, this net. So you can see how many nets are there in this case. So 25 nets are there, then 26, 27, 20, 29, 30. So it is 25 plus 5 plus 1. So this is 26 nets are there. So in this case, how many Stuckert faults should be there? It can be 2n, that is 26 into 2. But we will see that it is much less than that. So how do you do that? So we see that there is a Stuckert 1 fault here, and the pattern to detect this is this one, that is 0 at this net and 1 in others. Now you take another case. So now you take another Stuckert fault here. Initially this our fault was here. So for that our test pattern was this one. And now again we are considering another Stuckert fault at this point, which is again a Stuckert 1. Now let us see what test pattern can be applied. There can be many patterns which can be applied, but let us see one. So in this case this is a Stuckert 1. So our answer should go, what you should apply is a 0 over here. Now if the fault is there, this is 0, and if it is normal, sorry, if the fault is there, then this in the normal case the answer should be 0 over here and 1 in case of fault. So somehow you should apply a 0 over here. Similarly, this effect has to be delivered at this output. So all these things should be 1. Now how to make a 0 over here? So you can apply any one of these 5 lines are there. So accepting all ones, you can apply any other pattern. So if you apply all ones over here, then the answer will be 1 and your fault will remain undetected. So you can apply all zeros, you can apply 1, 0, 0, 0, 0 and so on. But let us apply the pattern which we applied earlier. So let us apply the pattern 0, 1, 1, 1, 1. So now in this case you see the answer is 0 over here if it is normal and fault. So this same pattern is actually testing Stuckert fault here. Stuckert 1 fault was tested here, as well as the same pattern is also testing a Stuckert 1 fault here. So in other words, this pattern is actually testing 2 faults in our group. So that means if you apply this test pattern and in the output you are getting a 0, then you know that there is not a Stuckert 1 fault here and not a Stuckert 1 fault here. Else this circuit may have a Stuckert 1 fault here and Stuckert 1 fault here, either of them. Now it is very important point to us for us to make, repeatedly I am saying, we have to keep it in mind that we are not going for diagnostics, because we are testing millions of circuits in a run, and if you find that this circuit is not working fine, you throw the circuit, and later on you can apply to find out slowly that is not much of a constraint, because you are then you may be wanting to know what went wrong, why there is a fault over here and why there is a fault over here. That is a diagnostic procedure which you can do slowly on a very few number of sample chips to find out where it went wrong. But for mass scale testing, we do not really bother whether the fault was here or whether the fault was here. We do not bother whether it was here or whether it was here. We just find out it is a fault and we have thrown the chip. So one test pattern, that is 0, 1, 1, 1, 1 and all ones, is testing a Stuckert 1 fault here and a Stuckert 1 fault here. So we have seen that one pattern tests more than one Stuckert fault. So we will see that much less than 2n number of test patterns are required to test all the Stuckert faults. So Stuckert test pattern, that is structural testing with Stuckert fault, has given us so many benefits. The first benefit is that you need not have any extra pinouts or any extra multiplexers or any extra scan shift registers for controllability and observability. Number of test patterns are required is much less than 2 to the power 2n. That is much less than 2 to the power n and also much less than 2n. Because one test pattern is able to test multiple number of faults. So that is the beauty of Stuckert fault model. And at the same time, the accuracy which has been found out statistically is about 99.9% plus. That is, it is saying that one test pattern, that is, if you are doing a full structural Stuckert fault testing, then you can be 99.9% confident the circuit does not have any fault. So that is the greatness of Stuckert fault model. So now let us look at the formal definitions of fault equivalence. So what is saying? It's saying that if two Stuckert faults F1 and F2 are called equivalent, if the output function represented by the circuit F1 is same as the represented by F2. That means what? If you have a circuit, say some circuit X. Now if there is a Stuckert fault F1, now what is the output function? The output function may be something in terms of the nets as well as the fault. Now, if there is another position fault which is F2, and if the output function remains same, then these two faults are called equivalent. And obviously, under such a case, same test pattern will be applied. Let us take an example of a very simple AND gate. So, let us see that if you have a, say, stuck at 0 fault over here. So, if you have a stuck at 0 fault over here, so what is the function? Function at this point? The function at this point is 0. Now, if you have a stuck at 0 fault over here, not here, then what is the function? The function is 0. Now, if you have a stuck at 0 fault at this point, then what is the function? The function is 0. So, you can say that in an AND gate, stuck at 0 here and stuck at 0 here are equivalent. Now, what is the test pattern to test this fault? It is 1. So, if for an AND gate, if you apply a pattern 1 1, then 3 stuck at faults are getting tested by 1 loop. So, that is what in this case there can, for an AND gate there can be 3 lines, 2 inputs and 1 this one. So, into 2 you have 6 faults, 3 stuck at 0 and 3 stuck at 1. Now, how many test patterns required to be tested? It is 6. Now, you can see surprisingly for stuck at 0 fault we require only one test pattern, that is 1 1, okay, because it is testing stuck at 0 here, stuck at 0 here, stuck at 0 here. And because this stuck at 0 faults at all the inputs of a AND gate are equivalent, because the output function f of the AND gate with a stuck at fault here or a stuck at fault here or a stuck at fault here is same, and that is called 0. So, therefore, we can represent an AND gate in the single stuck at fault model as simple as we can choose any point with a single stuck at fault, all faults are not required. So, you can say that I can have a stuck at 0 fault here. Then automatically if you represent a AND gate this way with a stuck at 0 fault at one input, then you need not bother about stuck at 0 fault here, stuck at 0 fault in this case. Because automatically if you are testing this stuck at fault, you apply 1 1 and automatically other two positions are tested. So, for a 2 input AND gate, the number of stuck at fault that needs to be tested is 1. So, it is much less than 2 n. So, we are always saving in this one. Now, you can also think about a 10 input AND gate, say. So, 10 input AND gate. So, number of input output lines are 11. 10 plus 1 11. So, in number of test pattern, number of stuck at fault possible is 22, number of test pattern is 22. But now, if you see the stuck at 0 fault, so if I say that I consider a stuck at 0 fault here, then what is the pattern to be applied? All ones. Okay, so, a stuck at 0 fault here at the first net, first input, all ones, test the stuck at 0 fault here, test the stuck at 0 fault at the output, and also a stuck at 0 fault at all the 9 other inputs. So, for a n input AND gate, then for even a, this is 2 inputs, so dot dot dot, you can make an even an n input AND gate. So, number of stuck at 0 faults that needs to be considered is only 1. So, if there are more number of input lines in a gate or a circuit, the fault equivalence plays a major role, because more number of faults, equivalent faults can be merged, and the number of test patterns or number of faults that need to be tested remains much less than 2 n, that is the number of this thing. So, we have seen that this happens for an AND gate. Now, let us see for other gates. So, this is an AND gate, so you have already seen that all the stuck at 0 faults are equivalent. Now, let us see a OR gate. So, if you see a OR gate, say this net is stuck at 1. So, what is the pattern to be applied to test the OR gate? You have to apply a 0 0 over here. So, if it is 0 0 and if it is stuck at 1, the answer is 1 if there is a fault, if there is stuck at fault, and the answer is 0 if there is no fault. You can very easily observe that the same pattern needs to be applied if this net has a stuck at 0 fault, and similarly if this net has stuck at 0 fault. So, for OR gate, this stuck at 1, all the stuck at 1 faults are equivalent, and you can just keep any one of them whichever you desire. So, you can see that AND gate and OR gate are basically dual of each other. So, in case of AND gate, so any one point you can have a stuck at 0 fault, but for OR gate, for any other point you can get a stuck at 1 fault. So, just a dual of each other. Now, if you go for the NAND gate, it is all very similar to AND gate. So, if you have a stuck at 0 fault here, so you have to apply 1 1. So, if the but only the output get reversed. So, you can see this the fault equivalent concept of AND and NAND gate are same. So, you can see that if the stuck at 0 fault in the NAND gate, so if you apply a 1 over 1, then the answer is 0 if there is no fault, but the answer is 1 if there is stuck at 0 fault over here, the answer is 1 if there is a fault kind of a thing. So, I mean you can easily find out. So, those things will we can these things are very quite obvious. So, you are not going much into details. Now, also in the case of what you call this inverter, stuck at 0 fault here you need to apply a 1, and for a stuck at 1 fault and this actually you need to apply a 1 over here, it is a stuck at 0 fault for an inverter. And also if there is a stuck at 1 fault at the output of an inverter, you have to apply a 1 over there, because you can just see if the stuck at 0 fault over here you apply a 1. So, if answer is 1 then there is a fault, and if there is a no fault, if the answer is 0, any one of them you can consider. Now, if you consider a stack at 0 fault over here, then you apply a 1 over here, the answer is 1 if there is fault, and the answer is 0 if there is no fault. So, for an inverter, these two stuff are equivalent. Similarly, a stack at 1 fault here is equivalent to a stack at 0 fault here for the case of an inverter. So, I mean, once you understand the concept of fault equivalence for an AND gate and an OR gate, other things are very much straightforward. But there is a very interesting fact when you come to what you call the fan outs. So, you can see this is a, as I already told you that in case of fan outs, we have to consider stack at 0 fault here individually and the stack at 0 fault here individually and the stack at 0 fault here individually. Because statistically we have seen that if you take one stack at fault over here and you do not take another 2 stack at fault here, then the accuracy was coming down to less than 99.9% plus or some numbers. So, to enhance it, people have found out that you have to consider stack at fault here. If you have a stack at fault here, then these two lines are obviously affected by the fault. But if a stack at 0 fault is here, then only this net is fan out is infected or is what you call this affected by this fault, and if there is a stack at 0 fault or stack at 1 fault here, then only this line is infected. But surprisingly, you see that these faults are not equivalent. I mean, it should have been equivalent, but it is not. So, you see why? Let us consider a stack at 0 fault here. So, if there is a stack at 0 fault here, then what happens in this net? I1 we call it, say it is 0 if the fault is there because the stack, and if no fault is there, the answer is 1. Obviously, if this is stack at 0, then you have to apply a 1 to test it. Similarly, for I double prime this net, so what happens if it is a 0, then if there is a fault because stack at 0, and if I1 is a value of 1, then there is no stack at 0 fault here because you are applying a 1 over here. Now, you see if there is a stack at 0 fault here, then what happened to sensitize the stack at 0 fault, you have to apply a 1. To apply a 1 over here, you have to get a 1 over here, that is very obvious. So, now what happens, you see, if I have a 1 over here, then if there is fault is there, then you get the answer is 0, and if it is 1, then there is no fault, that is obvious, because I put a 1 over here, I should get a 1 over here, but because the stack at 0 fault, this is 0. But this fault is over here, so this output is not affected by this one. So, what happens? It says that I double prime equal to 0 if fault, and I double prime is equal to, sorry, it should be stack at 0 fault, it is 1. So, it should be I double prime is equal to 1 if there is fault, and I double prime is 0 if there is no fault, because this fault is not affecting this line in any way. So, now what happens is that, so the presence of this stack at fault, so whatever is the functionality here, and with the stack at 0 fault here, whatever is the functionality at this point are not equivalent. Similarly, let us see, so in this case also it should be 1, I am sorry. So, what it says that if you apply a stack at 0 fault over here, so you have to apply a 1 over here. So, now if there is a fault, so this will be 0, but if it is no fault, so 1 will be propagated here, so the answer is 1. But this net is not affected by this fault, so I1 and this one will always be 1 with fault or without fault. Now, you can see that the output function by this, if the fault is here, the output function, sorry, these are both ones, the output function, this is a mistake, so these are both ones. So, the output function with a stack at 0 fault here and a stack at 0 fault one are not equivalent, because this one and this one is not matching with this one. Similarly, this one is not matching with this one. So, the output is different. So, even if the fan out is such a nice thing and looks similar, but these faults are not equivalent. So, you cannot have any merging between this fault. Like in an AND gate, we can easily merge this fault and we keep only a stack at 0 fault. For an OR gate, you can easily keep a stack at 1 fault here. But for a what you call a fan out, you cannot do any such kind of merging, because this fault, the output function, this one is not equivalent to this one with this output fault, and this fault, the output function, this one is not equivalent to any one of this. So, there cannot be any kind of merging, that is what is been explained here. So, fan out is very surprising, as I already told you. So, no merging and all these things can be possible. Now, let us take a simple example and illustrate the concepts. So, see, we have a circuit having a fault equivalence. So, this one. So, this is a circuit. So, now this is an AND gate. So, first we have to put all the 2N faults. So again I told you, we have to remember that. So stacked faults, when you are considering, for each line can be having a stacked 0 and a stacked 1, and we are considering one fault at a time. That means if there are multiple faults, can also be possible is multiple, that is a stacked 0 fault here and a stacked 0 fault, stacked 1 fault here. So two faults can also occur simultaneously, but then the number of all possible faults will be 3n, 3 to the power n. If you can see, because each line can be normal, it can be stuck at 0 and it can be stuck at 1. So in all, so its difficulty will be, we have 3 possibilities each net, and then the number of all possible test faults will be 3n, and the number of test patterns will be not 2 to the power n, but it will be 3 to the power n. And it is actually a much more complex problem to be solved. And in fact, we have seen that this is called multiple stacked fault model, that if you are considering more than one fault in a go. So we have seen that if you are taking multiple stacked fault model, then the confidence is somewhat 99.99 plus something. And if you are going for a single stacked fault model, then the confidence is 99 point something plus, and the marginal difference is very, very less, that the amount of accuracy is very, very less, and that does not merit investigation because the amount of cost to be paid for testing a single stacked fault model, the number of pattern is even less than 2n, okay, and in this case 3 to the power n faults are there. And then if collapsing will not be that much, because you can easily appreciate that this one and this one combination and this one combination to be equivalent or not, we have to do lot of the algorithm will be quite complex. In this case, the algorithm is very simple. For an AND gate, we know that these three faults are equivalent because the same functionality is there. But if I ask you that whether these two combination and these two combination are equivalent, the algorithm will be very, very complex. So the amount of cost paid in terms of computation, and the number of test patterns is the order of, if there are three AND faults, and then the number of test patterns is somewhat a very high order, then the amount of cost paid and the improvement of accuracy is not that high. So therefore, people have found out statistically that single stacked fault model they are quite happy with. So here also, we are fault equivalence based collapsing we will be doing, and also we are assuming the single stacked fault model. So let us have this one. So we see that this is the case with this AND gate. So you know that any one stacked fault you can keep. So let us try to say that we can keep any one of them. Similarly, for this case also we can keep any one of them, and this is an OR gate. So we have also seen that for OR gate you can keep either any one of them, in this fault or this fault or this, any one of them you can keep. So let us see what they have done. So we have seen, you have taken us this stacked fault, we have kept this stacked fault, you have kept, and this if we have done on the in the level 1, so we are going level wise. So this is the first level we have done. So in this case this stacked 0 fault, this stacked 0 fault, or these two are merged into this one, these things are all merged here, and in this case this stacked 0 fault and this stacked 0 fault are merged over here. So we are remaining with only two stacked 0 faults, as you can see over here. Now we are going to level 2. So you can see that in this OR gate, this three stacked 1 faults are equivalent, as we already discussed. So any one of them you can keep. So let us see what they have done. So we have kept only one stacked fault. So now initially if you look at it, so we had so many faults. So how many we have saved in this case? So out of these 3, 1, 2, 3, sorry, this is 4, 5, 6, and this is say 7, 8, 9. So 9 faults were there, which you can be merging or something. So among these 9 faults, we have kept only 3 of them. So it is 1/3 reduction has been possible. So out of these 3, we have kept 1. Out of these 3, we have kept 1. 4, 5, 6, we have kept 1, and 7, 8, 9, we have kept 1. So 1/3 fault reduction is possible by equivalence. So you can see over here. So this is level 2, this level, and finally, sorry, we have only one fault here, two fault here, three fault here, and some other faults like a stacked 0 fault here and some stacked 1 faults here are still remaining, for which we will see what we can do above with this. Okay, so we have 1/3 fault reduction. Now let us take another example where we are going to consider fan outs. Okay, so now again you see, as I told you, a very same thing will be like the previous example, but now there is a stacked 0 1 fault here, is also stacked 0 1 fault here, and here also stacked 0 1 fault here. And as is a fan out branch, so this one is independent, this one is independent, and this one is independent. So we have this one. So this is our circuit example. Now let us now investigate what is possible in this case. So in this case, if you see, this is a AND gate. So obviously, among them we can keep any one of them. Then this is a OR gate. Okay, so you can keep this one and this one and this one. You can keep any one of them. correct? So this is what will be the possible. So let us see what we can achieve. So in this case, you see for this AND gate, they have kept only one stack at 0, one stack at 0 fault over here, and these are for level 1, and if you do for a level 2, then again you can keep only a stack at 1 fault here for this gate and one stack at 0 fault. But you see, in this case, we have not been able to eliminate the faults over here, because this this net and this net is independent. So you can think, you can say that this stack at 0 fault and this stack at 0 faults are almost equivalent kind of a thing, but then we could have eliminated, because this is the input to this AND gate, and in AND gate a stack at 0 fault here, stack at 0 fault here, stack at 0 fault here, this thing can be merged. But you know that this line and this line are independent in FON, FN out. If this is stack at 0 fault, this line will be affected. Like for example, if I tell you, so this is a very interesting thing to observe, if I merge this stack at fault and this stack at fault, there is an effect which gets changed. You say that if I say that if this stack at 0 fault here, then a stack at, if a stack at 0 fault is here, then this line is affected as well as this line is affected. But if there is only a stack at 0 fault here, then only this line is affected. So there is two effect, and we require to have two test pattern for this. So this increase in, sometimes is also required an increase in the number of test patterns, because we are going down from 2n to a much less number. But sometimes if we are going too less in number, then may not be we are going to get the accuracy that was found out. So if you are keeping one more test fan out as an independent branch, so we require another test pattern for this line. So which we can see in the lecture in FinOS. So to increase the number of test patterns, we have kept the fan out lines as independent, which is giving a higher amount of accuracy. So but in the fault collapsing point of view, we just need to observe that we have collapsed this stack at 0 fault here, here and here, but we could not do anything with this. So this one is actually which we are having in the stack at fault model with fan out. But still we have a lot of drop in the number of faults. Now we will see another example, because in the last case we have seen that we could do a lot of things with what you call the stack at 0 fault. Now you can see that we have two stack at 1 faults over here. We have not done anything in this case. Similarly, in this case also we have, in the last example also we had some stack at 1 faults here, and these are the two stack at 1 for the AND gates, and some stack at 1 for the OR gate or something. So what we are going to see is that some faults still remain. So can we do something with this? So till now we have seen only we have collapsed faults by equivalence. Let us see if we can do something else. So now you see this is the same AND gate. So let us say a stack at 1 fault is there. So what pattern you have to apply? Simply you have to apply a 0 over here and a 1 over here. So you get the answer 1 if there is a fault, because the stack at 1 fault, and we are applying 0, 1. And if there is no fault, then what is going to happen? We are going to get a 0. Now let us say we take the another net. So in this case we get stack at 1 fault over here. Then what you are going to apply? You are going to apply a 1 over here and a 0 over here, and the same answer 1 if there is a fault and 0 if there is no fault. That is fine, but you can easily see that there are two different test patterns, and obviously the function, if there is stack at 1 fault over here, the function is I2. If the stack at 1 fault over here, then what is the function? The function of this AND gate is I2, because whatever I2 it will be passed. And if there is stack at 1 fault here, then what is the function of this AND gate? It is I1, because if it is stack at 1, then whatever the value here will be passed. So obviously the two outputs are different and these faults are not equivalent. So we cannot do anything using equivalence fault collapsing or equivalent fault theory if you are applying what do you call this stack at 1 is concerned. But now let us look at the stack at 1 fault at the output. So now what you can apply? You can apply 0, 0. So if you are applying 0, 0, 1 if there is a fault, because it will be stack at 1, and 0 if there is no fault. Similarly, you can apply 1, 0. The answer is 1 if there is a fault, and the answer is 0 if there is no fault. Similarly, also you can apply a 0, 1. That is, accepting 1, 1, you can apply any other pattern. Now say what I do, I just give you an idea. So let us think that what we can do. Say for example, I say that this, even these stack at 1 faults are not equivalent, but still I assume that they are equivalent. And I say that I just take a stack at 1 fault over here. Then what I can do, I can apply this pattern. Now by chance, say that I apply the pattern 0, 0. So obviously, this thing gets tested. But 0, 0 is not a test for this one and not a test for this one. So these two faults are not tested. So you cannot merge, or you can not do anything with this. But now let me just change the idea a bit. Instead of collapsing this fault, I just keep this stack at 1 fault and this stack at 1 fault. Then what happens, you see, then what I am going to do is that I need to apply this pattern to test this one, and I need to apply this pattern to test this one. So what happens if I test this fault and then I test this fault, twice I am testing a stacked one fault. Just observe this. So what happens, I am not considering stacked one fault here, I am just considering, because I saw that I may land into problems if I consider stacked one fault here and if I totally do away with this one. So what I have done now, I have just changed my thought a bit, and then what I have done, I have put a stacked one fault here and I put a stacked one fault here. Now what I am doing, to test a stacked one fault here, you apply a 0, 1 here. To test a stacked one fault here, you apply a 1, 0 over here. And if you look at this one, I am applying these two patterns, then twice I am also testing. So automatically what happens, these two together dominates this one, okay, or you can say these two together can cover this one, but one you cannot do it, because if I say that if I consider only a stacked one fault here, then what happens if I apply this one, then both of them are not tested. Then the worst case possibility you have to always consider. Now if I have only one stacked one fault here, then you are going to test this one fine, then you are also going to test this one fine, but then this one will not be tested, because to test a stacked one fault here, you will apply a 0, 1, and 0, 1 is not a test for a stacked one fault over here. So therefore, if we keep these two stacked faults at the inputs, then automatically the output stacked fault gets tested twice. So that is why we can say that this is another type of fault collapsing, which is called fault dominance. So this way also you can reduce the number of faults from 3 to 2. In the case of fault equivalence, what we have done? We have a 3 input and 2 input AND gate, and then we call from 3 stacked 0 faults, we have made it to 1. So also we have seen that if there is a 10 input AND gate, then 11 stacked 0 faults can be converted to 1. But in case of stacked 1 faults in AND gate, it is not that much reduction, but it is somewhat, at least you reduce the stacked fault at the output. That is, if you take this, if you take a stacked one fault at the input, stacked one fault at the input, automatically stacked one fault at the output is tested. So at least one fault you are reducing. So whatever you are reducing is good for us. So some reduction is there. So now, but it's not as high as fault equivalence. Now, so let us look at the formal definition. The formal definition states that if all tests for a stacked one fault, if all tests for a stacked F1 detects a fault F2, see, so all tests of stacked fault is F1. So all tests of stacked one fault, so for fault F1. So all tests for F1 is what? Only 0, 1, because this stacked one fault has only one pattern, so that is 0, 1. So we are saying that all tests of pattern F1 detect fault F2. So obviously this detect F2 is correct. Then F2 is dominating F1, so this is F2. So all tests of F1, this is the all test of F1, only one pattern is there, is detecting F2, then F2 dominates F1. So in this case, F2 is dominating F1, but you can easily see the definition other way does not hold. All tests, all patterns, if I consider this one as F1 and this one as F2, then see what happens, all tests of F2. So this is one test of F2, this is one test of F2, this is one test of F2. All tests of F1 should detect F2. So this one does not detect F2. So F2 does not dominate F1. But we can easily say that all tests of F1, that is single in number, is detecting this one. So F1 is detecting F2. So F2 is dominating this one. So F2 is actually dominating this one. Similarly, all tests of this guy, this is only one pattern of this guy, actually test this one. So this one also you can consider as F1. So it is saying that if all tests of fault F1 detect fault F2, then F2 dominates F1. So F1 is this fault, F2 is dominating this one as well as this one. Now if this is the case, then they say that if F2 dominates F1, then F2 can be removed and only F1 is retained. So you just eliminate F2 and you only retain F1. So basically the philosophy here is very simple. It says that all patterns of this guy or this guy detects this one. So you keep this one and you delete this one. Because if you do the other way around, then you may be in a problem. It says that in this case this is F2. This one pattern may detect this one, another pattern may detect this one, but there is some other pattern lying in this space which are not detecting these two. So if somehow you test this F2 using this remaining part, then these F1s will not be tested. So therefore, F2 dominates F1 means whatever available here can test this, so better you eliminate this one. Then automatically this guy will be tested more than once. So that is the concept of fault collapsing by fault dominance. So in this case, in case of AND gate, what is going to happen? You are having only one stacked one fault here, and automatically this can be retained. I mean, this can be eliminated. So let us see the generalized example. So in case of AND gate, this is the case. So one you can delete. So in case of OR gate, as I told you, you can easily verify that this is just the dual. So in case of OR gate, it is stuck at 0. So to test the stuck at 0 fault over here, so you have to apply a 0 and a 1 over here to test this fault. To test this fault, you have to apply a 0 over here and a 1 over here. And obviously, if you are applying a 0, 1 in this, so the answer is 0 if this is a fault, and otherwise is normal. So in this case also, you are applying 0 and a 1. So if you are applying, if you are applying something like 0 over here and a 1 over here to test it, then the answer is 0 if the fault is there and 1 if it is normal. Okay. So see, I can easily observe that 0, 1 and 1, 0 also test this fault. So in case of OR gate, you can easily eliminate out this. So inverter, this all faults were collapsed by this was the inverter. So this is only was stuck at 0, stuck at 1 fault, which was easily eliminated or collapsed by fault equivalence. But in case of fault domains, we need not consider the inverter. Again, these things are remaining same for the AND and the NOR gate. This is very obvious and you can easily understand. So now let us take another example, where we are going to see the fault dominance based collapsing. In the last example, we have got this circuit where we are using only fault equivalence to do the collapsing. So in this case, if you remember, we had a stuck at 0 fault here, we had the stuck at 0 fault here, stuck at 0 fault here, stuck at 0 fault here, and also we had a stuck at 1 fault here and a stuck at 1 fault here. So this guy and this guy were collapsed and we got this one. Similarly, this guy and this guy was collapsed and we got this one. So this guy and this guy got collapsed and we got this one. This was by equivalence. Now we will see what else, because some faults were still remaining. Let us see what we can do by using the dominance. So in the first level, you can already, in the first level you can see the, all this target one is already collapsed by equivalence with the AND gate, but these two can easily collapse this one, because if you are testing these two, automatically these two get tested. So this stuck at 1 fault is eliminated. And you can just also, you have to just remember the point that this is stuck at 1 fault over here. So this is get eliminated by this one, as well as this is also getting eliminated by a stuck at 1 fault by equivalence. So a single fault can be getting eliminated or collapsed by both. So this one get this stuck at 1 fault gets collapsed by equivalence with OR gate, as well as by dominance with this one. So similarly, we have this one is the final thing we have at level 1. Now if you go to this level, you have to just know that. So we have a stuck at 0 fault here and a stuck at 0 fault here. This you have to understand. So now who is having this stuck, controlling this stuck at 0 fault? These two stuck at 0 faults are actually being tested by this one. This is not shown here because they have already collapsed. But still they are, you have to know that if there is a stuck at 0 fault here and a stuck at 0 fault here, these two stuck at 0 faults are automatically getting tested. So if these two stuck at 0 faults are getting tested by fault dominance of an OR gate, this one is also getting tested. So this you can collapse by virtue of this two, and these two are getting collapsed by virtue of this one. So finally, we are having a circuit like this. So let me just repeat, the last part was a bit tricky. So there is a stuck at 1 fault here, which you can easily collapse by this one. But now also we had a stuck at 1 fault over here, sorry, a stuck at 0 fault over here, which we are not finding out how to collapse, because we are not seeing stuck at 0 fault here. But you have to understand that these two stuck at 0 faults are here, then they are actually being tested by virtue of these two. So these three gets collapsed by fault dominance, and this one gets eliminated and only these two remains. And again, these two gets eliminated by fault equivalence of this one and this one. So this is our final circuit we are having. So the number of faults here are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we have 6 faults here which needs to be tested. So we have 6 patterns required to be tested, and the number of nets here are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So 7 into 2, 14 faults were there. So we should have required 14 test patterns, but now with this collapsing, we have only 6 in number. So we have reduced the number of test patterns from 2 to the power 4, because 1 to 4 patterns are there, from 16 to 6. So this is a great achievement which we have done using stuck at fault model and what do you call the fault collapsing equivalence and dominance. Now let us again see the same example with both stuck at fault with equivalence and dominance, and we are looking at the fan out example. So this one is old example with fan out. So this is the circuit we have already got. What you can say, this is the circuit we have got after fault collapsing using only equivalence. Now let us see what we can do. Now if you see the level 1, so these are the two this stacked one faults are there. Now let us see what we can have. So this this is a stacked one fault already there. So because the OR gate is collapsing, so OR gate is this also stacked one fault over here. So this one, and this one, this collapsed all these stacked one faults, and now these are all collapsed by equivalent. So let us see what we can do in level one. So we do not have any changes at this level, but let us look at this last level. We can see that there is a change. So sorry, so this one we have level 1, so this is stacked faults with equivalence collapsing, but as you can see in level 1, that is we are considering this as level 1, there we cannot have any fault collapsing using dominance, because already we have both the stacked ones which is collapsing this stacked one, that is by dominance. So only what is left is in this level we may try something, because we know that in case of an OR gate, these 3 stacked 0 faults get collapsed by these 2 stacked 0 faults, but this stacked 0 fault is not visualized here because this guy is continuing over here. So that is what is achieved here. This is a stacked 0 over here. So this guy is controlling this, and these 3 stacked 0 faults are can be keeping these 2, this can be eliminated by fault dominance, and so we are having a circuit like this. So we are having this stacked 0, stacked 0, this stacked 0, this stacked 0, and this stacked 0, these are taken care of by this one by equivalence. And you can say that this stacked one is equivalent dominated by this one, and this is also eliminated, and there should have been a stacked 0 fault here. So which is actually again this is stacked 0 implies a stacked 0 over here, and these 3 guys by fault dominance actually eats up these 2, and we have linearly ended up with this one. So you can also see that also we have reduced the faults to a quite a large number, but now we have already seen that, but these guys and these guys, we cannot do any kind of elimination, because we have seen that these things are not equivalent in case of a what do you call fault dominance or fault equivalence. Fan out lines are not equivalent, or they are not dominated. So all these faults in individual fan out lines we have to keep. Okay, so now towards the end, or you can say that you have to understand a very interesting fact over here. So what is the interesting fact? You can see here, last example if you see. So where are the stacked faults? This is a circuit without any fan out. This is a circuit without any fan out. So what happens? All the faults are actually getting clustered over the inputs. No internal lines is having any kind of stacked faults, because all have been collapsed and brought to the input level, and this circuit does not have any kind of a fault, what do you call, sorry, any kind of a fan out. There is no fan out. So it is very obvious why it happens, because for any gate like AND gate, OR gate, NOT gate or whatever, so the fault, by fault equivalence, the fault at the outputs can be brought over here by equivalence, only one fault remains, and by fault dominance what happens, the output fault stacked 0 stacked 1 can be brought by equivalent number of faults at the by n number of faults at the inputs. Like this stacked one fault here are brought together by these 2 stacked fault one faults here. So the other dual thing happens for OR gate. This thing you can see that there is a stacked 0 fault over here, though, and there is a stacked 0 fault over. So both of them get converted in this one. So you can very easily see what happens. All the inputs are only having a stacked 0 fault, and the internal lines do not have any other stuff, any other fault that needs to be considered, because by fault dominance and fault equivalence, all the faults get transferred to the inputs of a gate. And if there is no fan out, then this thing holds transitively, and only the out inputs of a circuit have faults. So this gives a very, very less number. If a circuit internally has n nets, so you can know that the number of inputs will be much, much less than the number of internal lines. So then let be I. So in the worst case, only 2i number of stacked faults needs to be considered. That 2i also is the upper bound, because if it is an AND gate, then we will have only stacked 1 and only 1 stacked 0, and if it is the OR gate, then you will have the dual, then you have only this 2 stacked 0 and 1 stacked 1 in case it is an OR gate, and vice versa. So is the only the upper bound is 2i, where I is the number of input lines, and there will be also much somewhat less depending on the OR gate or the input. So we have come down from 2 to the power n to 2n, and from 2n to upper bound of 2i, where I is the number of input. So this is the beauty of stacked fault model. But if there is fan out, then the number slightly rises, because now why it rises you can already see. Now we have stacked faults at the inputs of the gates, that is fine, and also at the fan out branches, because these guys and these guys cannot be brought over here because they are not equivalent. So in addition to 2i, that is the number of inputs, again some 2f, or you can say 2f number, you have to add for the number of faults, because they are the number of fan out branches. Each fan out branches, we have a stuck at 0 fault and a stuck at 1 fault. Sometimes they will be merged with what you can call, say for example, in this case, this is a fan out and these are fan out. So this fan out is also the input of the gates, and this fan out is also the input of the gates. So and this is also some extra fault you have to have. So depending on the some fan out, say this is F. So we'll have some faults here, we'll have some fault here, but these faults and these faults cannot be collapsed. So and again two faults will remain. So if there are F fan out branches, so along with 2i, also 2f number of faults get added, then again this is the upper bound. So if you have fan out, then the number of faults or the number of test patterns in such a case is slightly higher than 2 into number of inputs, that is the number of 2 into number of fan out nodes. I mean, this starts a fan out, so this will have some extra faults. But if we had forgotten the concept of fan out, then these three faults could have been merged to this one. So this is actually called a checkpoint theorem, which says that if there is no fan outs, then the number of test patterns or the number of faults is 2 into the number of primary inputs upper bound, and if there is a fan out, then you have to put checkpoints in the primary inputs as well as the fan out cases. So the beauty of stuck at fault is that it detects, it says that it, if you have test pattern, I mean the beauty of stuck at fault model says that, and using checkpoint is saying that if you have a fan out, then you put checkpoints at the primary inputs as well as the fan out stems or the fan out branches, appropriate positions, and just find out what patterns to test it. Then the number of faults are much less than 2n, say some 2i plus 2p kind or 2f kind of a stuff, where if it is the number of fan out kind of a thing, then a very less number of patterns as well as a very less number of faults are required to be handled, which is much less than again 2n, and but still the statistically it has been shown that the confidence or the accuracy is as high as 99.9% plus. So in a nutshell, so what we have seen, the beauty of structural testing using fault models is that we need not have any extra pins, we need not have any extra registers, we need not have any extra multiplexers, as well as we can just apply some test patterns and verify that there is no stuck at fault model in any of the nets, and even the number of nets is say n, we do not require to apply even 2n patterns. The number of patterns are even much less than 2n, because by fault collapsing, by fault equivalence and fault dominance, the number comes to as the upper bound of 2i plus 2f if there is fan outs, and so the test time becomes very less, because what you can call that the idea is 2n, if n is the number of nets in the circuit are there, now you require 2n patterns, but by collapsing with the number comes to 2i plus 2f, where I and f are much less than n. So our test time is much less because the patterns are less. So we have solved a very big nightmare problem of test pattern or test time reduction. So we have reduced the number of test patterns, yes, having a accuracy of 99.9% plus, and our test time remains very low here because the number of patterns are less. So we have achieved our target using structural testing with fault models. And in the next sequence of lectures, we will see, given a test, even a fault, a stuck at fault, how can you automatically find out a test pattern? Because in our case, the circuits were very simple, having a AND gate, OR gate on 2 or 3 level of circuits were there. But it is a very complex circuit, then you have to find out, that also requires an algorithm to find out that given a test or given a fault, say F internally a circuit, how do you find out a test pattern that tests the fault? So that we will see in subsequent lectures. Now if you look at the question and answer session, so today we will ask you simple stuff so that we can see in the examples later. So for what class of circuits maximum benefit is achieved due to fault collapsing, and when benefits are less? What is the typical number of test pattern required to test this circuit? So very simply, you can say that if the circuits has very less fan outs, or if the circuit do not have any fan outs, then the number of faults are only equal to order of 2 to the number of primary inputs. So here you get a great benefit. But if the number of fan outs are very large, then slowly the benefit goes away because faults cannot be collapsed in the fan outs. So in a typical circuit, number of fan outs are never very high. So we always get a good amount of benefit when you are, what do you call, you are taking a fault collapsing by fault equivalence and dominance. But if you have a high number of fan outs, then slightly the benefit is less. The second question is, what faults can be collapsed by equivalence in case of an XOR gate? So we have seen in our study AND gate, OR gate, inverter, NAND gate, but we have not seen XOR gate. So what is the case? Can we do anything by fault equivalence? The answer is no, Because for fault equivalence, the answer is to be that with a fault here and with a fault here, the output function for this one and this one should be equivalent. But this is not the case in case of XOR gate. So, we cannot have any fault collapsing in this by equivalence. You see, if I have a stack at 0 fault here, so what is the answer? The answer is I1. If I1, so to have a stack at 0 fault here, what you have to do it? You have to apply 1, 1. So, what is the function? If there is a stack at 0 fault here, then what is the answer? I1 if there is a fault. So, if there is a fault over here, so the 0 is actually propagating, I1 is get propagating. And if there is no fault, the answer is I1 XOR I2 if there is no fault. Now, if there is a stack at 0 fault over here, so what happens? We know that an XOR gate is a controlled inverter. So, if one line is 0, then XOR gate actually passes whatever is in the output. And if it is a 1, then X1 passes the inversion. Okay, so, in this case, if it is stuck at 0 fault over here, so obviously, stuck at 0 fault over here, so whatever happens is actually this I1 gets passed through. Actually, we should write it say I2, I mean just it was some mistake from my side, it is I2 because it is a controlled inversion. So, if you stuck at 0 means whatever is available here will pass, I2 if there is a fault. Now, in this case, if you see if it is stuck at 0 fault over here, then what happens? It is I1 if there is a fault and because I1 gets passed because the controlled inversion stuck at 0, so it will be passed. If there is no fault, it is I1 XOR I2. So, this I2 and I1 are not equivalent. So, that is a problem. Now, if you have a stuck at 0 fault over here, so what is the answer? Is I1 XOR I2 if no fault and it is a 0 if there is a fault. So, you can see that neither of them are equivalent. Now, in this case you see, if it is stuck at 1 fault over here, then what is the answer? It is a controlled inverter. So, 1 means it is inversion. So, I2 will be inverted and it will be going over here. And if there is no fault, it is simple XORing. Now, in this case, if you see it is stuck at 1 fault over here, then I1 will be inverted and it will be here. And is I1 XOR I2 if there is no fault. And if the stack at 1 fault here, 1 and x1, x, XOR, x2, there is no fault. So, neither of them are equivalent. So, we cannot have any kind of fault collapsing for an XOR gate. So, if your circuit has too many XOR gates, then we say that it is a not a good design from a testability point of view. So, thank you and we come to the end of this lecture. So, from in next lectures onwards, we will see how to generate test patterns automatically given the faults. Thank you.